Comic books have become mainstream in the past few years, with multiple live-action adaptations of their stories garnering billions of dollars. Live-action superhero films are truly a success, both critically and financially. But surprisingly, out of all of the comic book movies released on a theatrical scale, only five of them are animated. These five are Batman Mask of the Phantasm, the Lego Batman movie, Teen Titans Go to the Movies, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and Captain Underpants. It's a shame that we've had so few animated comic book movies on the big screen, because I think the medium of animation can adapt comic book stories in a unique way that live action just can't. My name is Josh C, and today I'm going to give you guys some points on why animation can capture comic books in a more accurate way and can adapt the comic art form in a way that live action can't, and hope to convince you guys to see the beauty of animated comic book adaptations. Before I start, I just want to clarify that this is not an attack on live-action superhero and comic book movies. I started reading comics in 2016 because of them. There will always be a place for them in cinema because they have their own advantages as well. The purpose of this video is to show that animation can capture comics in some aspects more uniquely and creatively than live action can. This video is also not an attack on comic books. I'm going to be comparing animation and comic books in this video and their similarities, but comics are still totally different from animation and you should go read them because they're amazing. Anyway, let's begin. The first point on why I think animation can capture comic book stories well is because of how well it can adapt art styles. Comic book art is essential and can affect the story's quality, enhance the story's tone and feeling, and drastically alter the final product. It gives the characters and the world its own life and style. The detailed watercolor backgrounds with simple anthropomorphic Disney-style characters in Black Sad results in a world that feels intricate and old, but is filled with characters full of expression and life. The colorful and adorable art of I Hate Fairyland balances the hyper-intense gore seen in the story, while fitting in with the story's silly and exaggerated characters. These are just two examples of art affecting the final product, but this is the case for every comic you read. This level of variance in style can be achieved to a certain degree in live action, but not to the extent that comic books and animation can. Stuff can be changed, like the color intensity of the movie or the lighting in the movie, but it won't have the same strong impact that animation comic books can have. This isn't to bash live action, because the style of making something feel real on camera is amazing in itself, and works for a ton of stories. It's just that they can't adapt or recreate art styles to the extent that comics and animation can, because all the visuals you see in animation and comics are made from the mind of creators. Look at those five theatrically released comic book animated movies I mentioned earlier. All of them vary in style and can easily be distinguished from one another. These unique styles of animation also help them stand out and affect the film in a special way, just like art in comic books. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse's animation, with its color intensity, stylized characters and world, lack of motion blur, intentional frame drops, and incorporation of comic book elements like captions and sound effects, make the film feel like a comic book come to life, and make extremely intense and crazy moments heightened even more, while still feeling like it belongs in the film because of the art style of the movie. Song of the Sea, which might be one of, if not my favorite animated movie of all time, is a good example for this. It's probably one of the slowest paced animated movies of all time, but it's not boring at all. This works because of the animation in the film. The animation in Song of the Sea is probably the most gorgeous animation I have ever seen. The slow pacing helps us appreciate the animation while the animation keeps us entertained and not bored throughout the whole film. The animation is so good that you can pause the film at any moment and that can make a decent wallpaper. Art style is something in comics that animation can adapt well, and if more animated comic book movies with unique and special art styles come out more often, I doubt we would be in superhero fatigue, because each comic book movie would stand out, even on a visual standpoint. The next reason why I believe animation suits comic books very well is because of special effects. Comic book stories often have a lot of action scenes and unreal things, so adapting comics into film would require a lot of effects. Effects in blockbusters are kind of in a weird place right now. Technology has made it very easy to make good and decent special effects. But when you look at recent comic book movies, don't you see the mixed quality of CGI in them? Henry Cavill's face in Justice League and the fake-looking Black Panther final fight scene are examples of this. Also, compare how Iron Man suited up back in the day against how fake he looked in some scenes in Avengers Infinity War. These studios have a huge budget, but why do some of their scenes look clunky sometimes? The reason behind the occasionally bad CGI in movies today isn't because they aren't capable of creating scenes with effects that look real. It's because the amount of special effects in modern movies is a lot, and effects teams are rushed to do their work as fast as possible with terrible deadlines. Digital effects back in the day were not super amazing, but they were pretty good for their time. This was also partly because of practical effects. Sam Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy used a lot of real sets and practical effects. Dr. Octopus's arms in Spider-Man 2 were real and were puppets being controlled by puppeteers behind the scenes. The CGI in the Spider-Man trilogy isn't spectacular, but Raimi usually follows up a shot with special effects with a shot using practical effects, which makes the film CGI not obvious and bothersome. Because of the use of practical effects in these films, effects teams could also spend their time polishing their effects to make them the best they can be. Spider-Man swinging scenes in all three of these movies are truly special and hold up pretty well, even by today's standards. Nowadays, there are so much effects that the effects team have to do in such a short amount of time, so they can't really polish their work anymore. Effects artists no longer have the luxury of creating the best work possible because of the amount of labor they need to do in such a short amount of time. They can still make amazing CGI though, like Thanos in both movies and the effects team who did Lion King. Too bad everything else except the CGI sucked. The idea of remaking Lion King with the same story but with fancy and photorealistic animation is a terrible idea and should not have been done. Anyway, back to the topic. Effects in live action can be amazing but can also be kind of terrible. It's a good thing that this isn't really a problem in animation. With animation, you don't really have a limit to what you can create. It's not a problem for animators to create fantastical things that don't exist in real life. That's kind of the point of animation. You can literally create anything with animation and have it look clean and nice. Comic book stories are known for their intense action and wild stories, and that's something that animation can do really well without limits. My last point on why I think comics suit animation well is because animation can adapt the weirdness in comic books. One thing that I believe animation and comics have in common is just how weird they both are. Early animation was about doing the impossible and accomplishing what live action can't. One of the earliest animated shorts was a silent short of a man talking with a dinosaur doing really weird stuff. Disney even made an entire short in 1929 dedicated to dancing skeletons, which is weirdly cool. Animation is about creating the impossible, and making what may seem as an oddity into something magical and wonderful. Not only is animation weird from the past, but even the ones recently. The whole premise of Ratatouille, Cars, the Lego Movie, and more are just so unique, creative, and interesting. Most animated films can't be recreated in live action, just because of how weird their world and story are. One amazing, fairly recent example of this is the miniseries Over the Garden Wall. Over the Garden Wall is about two boys, Greg and Wirt, trapped in the unknown and trying to get back home. The miniseries is truly amazing and is a thrill to watch. A notable thing about the show is how odd everything is in the place most of the show takes place in. The unknown is filled with characters from different periods of time, anthropomorphic animals in schools, frogs that play instruments better than you can, and a whole dreamland that does not make sense at all. All this weirdness makes the show unpredictable, and makes you anticipate what crazy thing will happen in the following episode. Comics are also known for being really weird. Since 1938, when the Man of Steel debuted, lifting a car in red and blue tights, craziness was a staple in comic books. Superheroes in capes and tights with silly names fighting crazy villains in cities are a normal thing. Characters die and come back to life in almost an instant. Odd creatures in alternate universes are common in comic book worlds. Comics are home to all kinds of weird and wacky stories that you never thought you wanted to read. Want a mature story about an imaginary real devil forcing man to kill a person every month? Kill or Be Killed is the right story for you. Want a comic book about a guy who ends up being the only male on the planet and tries to get to his girlfriend all the way in Australia? Why the Last Man is perfect for you. The mature science fiction story Saga is probably the best example of how weird and amazing comics can be. The story of Saga is about two parents coming from two races that hate each other and raising a child. They travel around the galaxy, get friends along the way, and slowly raise their child up. The weird thing about the comic is also like the unknown in Over the Garden Wall, in that the universe in Saga is so crazy and weird. There are cat lie detectors, ghost babysitters, an entire kingdom of robots, an adorable seal who can talk and has a golden axe, and a bunch of space meerkats with their own organized religion. Comics is an art form that is low risk to produce. So, writers and artists come up with these weird, wacky stories that will really take your breath away. This weirdness is something that, as described earlier, can be adapted in animation pretty well. So if comic book stories can fit in animation as well as, if not better than live action can, why isn't there more comic book animated content? Well, there is actually a decent amount of comic book animated content released each year. Young Justice got revived last year and Teen Titans Go did so well that there was even a theatrically released movie about it. An enjoyable and funny Harley Quinn animated TV show came out last year and it's still ongoing and pretty cool. The line of DC animated movies has been growing every year as well. And Marvel announced last year their What If show will be animated. The thing is, I believe comic book animation should be pushed more. These studios are making animated comic book content, but they're not massively funded and are not really given priority. This is why some of the animated content we have received in the past few years are mediocre and lazy. If comic book animation is funded well, led by talented creators, and given priority by studios, then comic book animation would be at its full potential and can become as well as, if not better, than the live-action superhero films and TV shows we get so frequently every year. The reason why animated comic book content isn't prioritized and not many appear on the big screen is because of one thing. That's money. The truth is that comic book animated content, as unique and creative as they can be, don't make that much money. Batman, Mask of the Phantasm, regarded as one of the best Batman movies of all time, flopped at the box office, grossing a measly $5.6 million worldwide compared to its $6 million budget. It was only when the film was put into VHS that the film ended up earning over its budget. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, despite winning the Oscar for Best Animated Feature and being super well received, didn't do as well as you might think. It grossed $375 million worldwide with a budget of $90 million. This is pretty good and sounds like a lot. But Aquaman, released around the same time as Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, grossed over $1 billion worldwide. Aquaman, despite its mixed reviews, earned more than two times what Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, a revolutionary film that changed the way we view comic book animation, earned. These two examples show you just how underrated animation is. Although a lot of us have developed the idea that animation isn't a genre for children, but a form of art that is compelling as any other, many people still believe otherwise. This is sad, because there is so much good animation out there for all kinds of people. You guys just need to find them and support them. This is what we need to do. The next time animated comic book content comes out on the big screen or is released on streaming services, watch it and support and share your love for it. If we actually support animated comic book content, both vocally and financially, then studios will notice. Then hopefully more high quality comic book animation will populate entertainment to show that comic book animation can be unique, creative, and fresh. I want another Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and I'm pretty sure you do too. The health of comic book animated content is in your hands, and I hope you support it. Anyway, that is all for today. Hope you enjoyed, and thank you guys so much for watching. It really means a lot to me. Also, read comic books, because they're amazing. And speaking of comic books, I'm going to make more specific comic book related videos this year, probably, because I'm thinking of doing a whole series where I highlight comic books and their historical significance and why they're great. And I hope you look forward to that. Anyway, leave a like if you really enjoyed this video and subscribe if you want to see more. My name is Joshua C, and I will see you in the next comic book video.